Majesty, if you were king, you wouldn't be afraid of anything?
Not nobody. Not nohow.
Not even a rhinoceros?
Imposterous.
How about a hippopotamus?
Why, I'd thrash him from top to bottom.
Supposing you met an elephant?
I'd wrap him up in cellophane.
What if it were a brontosaurus?
I'd show him who was king of the forest.
How?
How? Courage. What makes a king out of a slave? Courage. What makes the flag on the mast to wave? Courage. What makes the elephant charge his tusk in the misty mist or the dusky dusk? What makes the muskrat guard his musk? Courage. What makes the Sphinx the seventh wonder? Courage. What makes the dawn come up like thunder? Courage. What makes the Hottentot so hot? What puts the ape in apricot? What have they got that I ain't got?
Courage.
Oh, you could say that again.
Courage. Courage. Something that every one of us, in some aspect, deal with on a daily basis. Something that all of us at one time have thought, maybe I should have more of that. Courage. We're going to be in 1 Samuel chapter 14 today, if you want to turn there, 1 Samuel chapter 14. And I want to tell you a couple little stories about myself when it comes to courage. 2 years ago, I was in Costa Rica with a group of teens, and we went to, on our free day, this place where you do zip lining, and it's not just normal zip lining, it's zip lining on steroids, like 300-400 feet in the air, over valleys, and we went rappelling down a raging waterfall. I was fine with all of that. The teens that were with me, if they're here this morning, know this next part. Then came tightrope across a 300-foot, the first of all was 300-foot valley, and then over a little shorter area, but a different kind of tightrope. And I put my foot on that. There was little handles on each side on the first one. And I started going across. And I'll be very honest with you. I thought everything in my body was just going to fall apart. I was freaking out with everything inside of me. And I can't let this happen because on the first one, here is the Sally's kid, 9 years old at that time, going, PC, come on, hurry up. And I'm going, Matthew, if you know what's good for you, you better keep your mouth shut right now. And I'm sliding my feet across this thing. I get across it. We go rappelling on the next one, and we do another zip line. I'm feeling pretty good. And all of a sudden, one of the teens behind me, Laura Bauman, she goes, guess what's next? I was like, what? Another tightrope. I mean, I already made a fool of myself once. But this one, the whole group, I'm one of the last ones to go. The whole group is on the bottom watching me. And I go across this thing. And on this one, you have to grab the ropes as you go across like this. And as you're going, you're shuffling your feet. If you want to see a funny video, ask Kevin Kahila. He took one. My good friend from the bottom. And I'm going across this thing. And after about 2 minutes of me shaking like this, grabbing each rope, I cheated and grabbed the top rope and went across. But after I was all done, here comes Laura Bauman. I literally could not believe what she did. I mean, she runs across this thing without touching any rope. And all of a sudden, 5 seconds later, she's behind me. She goes, PC, that wasn't that bad, was it? You little jerk. You little jerk. Courage. Courage. It amazed me, because I rappelled fine. I did the steroids on the zip line just fine. I didn't do steroids. I did the zip line on steroids. And but man, that thing, that tightrope got me. And some of you remember this picture from a couple years ago when I told a story about the high dive. My brother used to jump off cliff jumping, and he'd go like 200 feet into the big pool off the cliffs. And I never did that. I did about the 10-foot one every time. And all my friends would, come on, Chuck, try it. Nah, I don't want to do it. You see, I got this ear problem. Whenever I jump into a pool, my ears don't pop. When I'm going on a plane, I have to wear these little blue things that look like screws to go in my ears to make my ears pop as we go down. And we're on a family vacation, picture's a little small, but the two guys in the back are my brother and my father. And my brother and father are making fun of me while I'm jumping off this thing. And I went up the ladder, and that's much higher than it looks, by the way. I went up the ladder, and if you look in the corner of the picture, there's two little kids. And as I was going up, I was like, oh, no. Two little kids come up behind me. This is not going to be good, especially my brother-in-law, my brother, and my dad standing there. And I get to the top of that thing, and I was like, I don't know if I want to do this or not. I start turning around because I'm like, I don't have to do this. This is not something I have to do. So I start turning around. I look up. I look down the back of the board. Here's two little kids looking at me. And one goes, Mister, are you going to go? And I look down, and my father by this time is sitting in a chair holding his sides. He's laughing so hard. I go, thank you, Father. You are such a great encouragement in my life. And he was like, just jump, you weenie, just jump. I said, all right. So this is me finally stepping off the board, not jumping, and holding my ears for all it's worth, laying in the pool, and my brother-in-law, and father laughing at me the whole way. I get out of the pool, and Mom goes, why did you wait so long? Mom, I jumped. She shook her head at me like this. So I was like, Mother, I jumped. Give me a break. Courage. Sometimes, like Cowardly Lion, we need it. Sometimes in our life, we really struggle with courage. We really struggle when it comes to reaching out to the person that we know in our neighborhood. We really struggle sometimes to have courage to step up at school when we know we need to do the right thing. How can I have courage to stand? That's the question today. How can I have courage to stand? 1 Samuel chapter 14. One of my favorite Bible stories about Jonathan and his armor bearer fighting the Philistines. Some background on this. Israel is at war with the Philistines. Let me just premise this a little bit. The Philistines were the biggest, baddest army on the face of the earth at that point. Goliath came from them. Goliath's brothers came from them. They were not some small little people. Israelites were about 5'4", 5'5", on average back then. Remember Goliath, 9'9". These guys are huge. They learned to fight from their youth. These guys have it. They know what's going on when it comes to battle. They have all the tools that they want. I mean, it'd be like if you put Iron Man, the Hulk, Chuck Norris, Rocky Balboa, Arnold Schwarzenegger fighting against me. That's a scary thing. I think I'm a pretty bad dude. But you know what? They'd kill me. It wouldn't even be a fight. And that's what the Israelites are going up against, the Philistines. The Philistines had killed off the Israelite blacksmiths at this point. You look at chapter 13, verse 19, it says, now a blacksmith could be found in the whole land of Israel, because the Philistines had said, otherwise the Hebrews will make swords or spears. Verse 22, so on the day of the battle, not a soldier with Saul and Jonathan had a sword or spear in his hand. Only Saul and his son, Jonathan, had them. No blacksmiths make swords. Israel's going to fight with rakes. When the Philistines and the Israelites met for battle, only King Saul and his son Jonathan had swords. The Philistines were in complete control. It'd be like me and you going out with BB guns. And the guys that I said, Iron Man, Rocky Balboa, Chuck Norris, coming out with AK-47s against us. Philistines were in complete and utter control. The Israelites, without God, had no chance. First thing is this, how can I have courage to stand? How can I have courage to stand? Let's look first the difference between Saul and Jonathan. Saul was a head taller than all the rest of the men of Israel. He was a chosen leader. The Israelites looked to him for guidance, for leadership. And if you look at chapter 14, look at verse 1. One day Jonathan, son of Saul, said to a young man bearing his armor, come, let's go over to the Philistine outpost on the other side. But he did not tell his father. Saul was staying on the outskirts of Gilboa under a pomegranate tree in Migron. With him were 600 other men, among whom were Adijah, who was wearing an ephod. He was son of Ichabod's brother, Abitab, son of Phinehas, the son of Eli, the Lord's priest in Shiloh. No one was aware that Jonathan had left. Now, Saul, king of Israel, the leader, the one that everybody looks up to. What is he doing when the Philistines are coming very close to them on one of their outposts? He's sitting under a tree with some of the main guys, the priest, his advisors, 600 of the big fighting men. He's sitting under a tree. And a lot of people think he was sitting there because you know what God was going to do. He didn't know exactly what was going to happen, and he was pouting. And his son Jonathan said, I'm not going to have any of this, Dad. He looks at his armor bearer, and I affectionately call his armor bearer Arnie, by the way, because he has no name in the story, and he has a huge, he's a huge part of the story. So Arnie and Jonathan are going out to try and look at this outpost and see if they can defeat it. Look at verse 4. Either side of the pass that Jonathan intended to cross to reach the Philistine outpost was a cliff. One was on Boaz and the other one Senna. One cliff stood to the north toward Michmash and the other toward Geba. So here's a little background on the situation where they're at. The pomegranate tree where Saul is on this one cliff over here. The outpost is on another cliff over here, and there's a valley in between. So Jonathan's armor bearer are going to go down this cliff through the valley and up the cliff to look at the Philistines on the other side, just to see where they're at and maybe defeat them. Here's the difference between Saul and Jonathan. Saul didn't really realize what God could do. And Jonathan, he knew who he served. Jonathan understood that because of God's strength in his life, that he was going to trust him through this. How can I have courage to stand? Number one is this. Put your faith and trust in our big God. Look at verse 7. Verse 6, excuse me. Jonathan said to his armor bearer, Arnie, come, let's go over to the outpost of these uncircumcised fellows. I just love how he says that, by the way. Perhaps the Lord will act on your behalf. Nothing can hinder the Lord from saving, whether by many or by few. Jonathan looked at Arnie, his armor bearer, and said, Arnie, we're going to go over and do this. I believe my God is big. I believe my God is all-powerful. I believe my God can do anything, and I'm going to trust him because, as we sang this morning, the battle belongs to the Lord. And we're going to go over. We're going to look at these Philistines in the eye, and if God wants us to fight them, we're going to fight them. I want us to do something this morning because all of us need to just wake up a little bit in here and in Connections. Everybody stand up. Connections, stand up too, please. And if you're online watching your pajamas, stand up as well. I want you all, we're going to sing a song that I love. My God is so big. And there's motions with it. And it goes like this, the chorus. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do for you. All right. As Pastor Steve says, we're going to sing it with full voice. We're going to sing it very manly. Try that, ladies. Because this is a big song. We're going to sing it with gusto. Ready? We're going to sing it together. And we're going to do the little part where it says, the mountains are his, the valleys are his, the stars are his handiwork too. So get ready. Here we go. Ready? My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do for you. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do for you. The mountains are his, the valleys are his, the stars are his handiwork too. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do for you. It's amazing to watch some of you do that. You're stepping out of your comfort zones, and I'm very proud of you. You can sit down. My God is so big. How can I have courage to stand? By putting your faith and trust in our big God. Putting our faith and trust in our big God. How would our life look different? How would it look different if we were to say, God, I know that you are the almighty God of the universe. I know that you're the creator. I know that you are the sustainer of my life in every aspect. And because of that, I'm going to live for you 100%. Because you are the big God. the God, the only God, the God that I trust completely. How would your life look different in light of that? How would this church look different if the members and people of this church said, you know what, God? You're the most important thing to me. You're the most important thing to me, and I'm going to live for you because you are the most powerful person, most powerful God, the only God. I'm going to live for you 100%. How would our marriages look different? If we were to say, God, because of who you are in my life, I'm going to live for you 100%. How would our relationships with our children look different? How would they be different? Living for God, putting your faith and trust in our big God. That's what Jonathan did here. He said, Arnie, we're going over there. We're going to fight the best we can. We're going to trust God is going to help us every step of the way. And we're going to do this for his honor and for his glory. How can I have courage to stand? By putting your faith and trust in our big God. Number two, surround yourself with friends you can trust and count on. Surround yourself with those on the same mission as you, going the same way as you. Look at verse 7. Look what Arnie says. This is pretty amazing. Do all that you have in mind, the armor bearer said. Go ahead. I am with you, heart and soul. That word heart and soul there actually means everything that I have. I got your back. Let's do this together. How many of you have a friend that doesn't coddle you every time? They aren't yes men or yes women in your life. How many of you have a friend that asks you the tough questions? That truly are there because they want to see you grow closer to Jesus Christ? How many of you are that kind of friend to someone else? Arnie said right here, John, I got you. Everything you want to do, I'm right here with you, 100%. And I'm going to back you up. I'm going to be there for you. Surround yourself with friends you can trust and you can count on. Proverbs 27:17, very familiar verse. As iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. We're there for each other, asking each other the tough questions, making sure that we're growing, making sure we're doing the right things. When we get out of step spiritually, we go and we confront in love. We come alongside in times of sadness and despair, and we talk to them. We comfort them. We're patient with people. We love on them, and we try to bring them back to the fold. They try to bring them back to where they need to be spiritually. As iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. Another one, Proverbs 27:6. Wounds from a friend can be trusted, but an enemy multiplies kisses. Ponder that verse for a second. Wounds from a friend can be trusted. Some of us do not like to be confronted by somebody else. I don't like it. I know I'm not right all the time, but when someone comes at me, what's my first initial reaction? Look at your life, man. Why are you talking to me? But each one of us need to look at the wounds of a friend when they come, and they come in love and are trying to help us grow, and they point something out in our life that we need to work on. Wounds from a friend can be trusted, but an enemy multiplies kisses. Do you have a friend like that, that comes alongside of you and helps you? Ecclesiastes 4:9-10. Two are better than one because they have a good return for their work. If one falls down, his friend can help him up. But pity the man who falls and has no one to help him up. Do you have friends that come alongside of you, that back you up heart and soul as Arnie does for John? You have friends that ask you the tough questions. And to reverse that, are you that kind of friend? Are you there just to have fun with your friends? Are you there to help them grow closer to our Savior? It's amazing when friends that are on the same page, they're going the same direction as these lions on the page, on the screen up there. It's amazing when those kind of friends get together for a Bible study. Maybe just to hang out, but then they ask some spiritual questions to each other. It's not just small talk. It's so awesome to be a part of that and really get into each other's lives. I pray that you have a friend like that. I pray that you are a friend like that to someone else. How do I have the courage to stand up? I surround myself with friends I can trust and I can count on. Look at this next thing. If you were to look at the book Art of War or look at strategy books on war, this is not one of the things you would find. But look what happens here. Verse 8. Arnie and Jonathan are going through the valley, up the cliff to the outpost of the Philistines. Jonathan said, "Come then, we will cross over toward the men and let them see us. If they say to us, 'Wait there until we come to you,' we will stay where we are and not go up to them." Basically, we run. But, verse 10, "If they say, 'Come up to us,' we will climb up, because this will be a sign that the Lord has given them into our hands." All right, think about this for a second. This crazy plan. Show themselves to the Philistines. Basically, they're going to climb up this cliff, as in that picture there. They're going to look over the top, and just like the Geico Gecko, go, "Hello." That's their plan. If the Philistines say, "We'll come down to you," that means we hightail out of there. The Philistines are up there and say, "Come on up here, let's teach you a lesson." That means, "Okay, God, you gave them into our hands. We're going to go defeat them." I don't know if I trust that plan very much. Arnie was a great friend. I look at Jonathan and go, "You are nuts, man. We're not going to do that. There's 50 guys up there." Show themselves to the Philistines. If they say, "We will come down to you," we run. If they say, "Come up to us," God has given the victory. Look what happens. Verse 11. So both of them showed themselves to the Philistine outpost. "Look," said the Philistines, "the Hebrews are crawling out of the holes they're hiding in." The men of the outpost shouted to Jonathan and his armor bearer, "Come up to us and we'll teach you a lesson." Can you imagine what's going through Jonathan and Arnie's mind at this point? Wow, God, all right. I mean, the Philistines just said to him, "Come up here and we're going to teach you a lesson." It's probably more like, "Come on up here and we'll teach you a lesson." And you can see Jonathan's eyes go, "Oh yeah, here we go, baby." And here comes Arnie and Jonathan hightailing up that cliff. Look what happens. This is amazing. So Jonathan said to his armor bearer, "Climb up after me. The Lord has given them into the hand of Israel." Jonathan climbed up using his hands and feet with his armor bearer right behind him. The Philistines fell before Jonathan, and his armor bearer followed and killed behind him. In that first attack in verse 14, Jonathan and his armor bearer killed some 20 men in an area of about in half an acre. Think about this. Who had swords in this battle? Jonathan. What did the armor bearer have? Maybe a rake. I don't know how much damage you can do with a rake without the power of God on your side. They're fighting against Iron Man. They're fighting against the Hulk, Chuck Norris, Rocky Balboa, Arnold Schwarzenegger with AK-47s. And here is Jonathan saying, "You know what? We have the courage because we have the Almighty God, the universe on our side, the big God. I have a friend following behind me, killing behind me, named Arnie, that's with me, that's helping me in every instance, that is with me heart and soul. He's my best friend, and he's going to fight with me." And then when they get up there, the third thing, how we can have courage to stand, is this: go all out. Here's Jonathan. You can just picture it with me. It says he's climbing with both hands and both feet. He probably has a sword in his mouth. And he's saying, "God, this is all for you. Everything that I have right here, I'm putting my life on the line for my country and for you." I want to ask you a question this morning. In your spiritual life, in this life that we're running, this race, this battle that we're in, are you going all out? when it comes to your devotional life, when it comes to your prayer life. Let's be honest with ourselves this morning. Only really you and God know how deep you go in your prayer life, in your devotional life. Only you and God know how much you actually put into it. Do you go all out in your devotional and prayer life? What about when it comes to service? When it comes to being a servant to others in your household, with your kids, with your wife, with your husband, at church? Are you going all out? Are you giving it your all? What about your marriage? Husbands, wives, are you saying, I'm going to love my wife with everything that I have? I'm going to have courage to stand up, maybe make myself a little vulnerable, and be a servant to my wife, be a servant to my husband, love them with everything that I have, go all out and say, God, I'm doing this for you, just like Jonathan. I'm going to have the courage to do the right thing because I serve a big God, because I have friends holding me up and pushing me towards God, and because I'm going to stand here and say, God, because you have given me the victory, because you are my Savior, because you are my King, I am going to give everything that I have to you in every aspect of my life. Going all out, is God worth it to you? That's a question each one of us personally have to ask ourselves. In our life today, do we have the courage to stand up and say, God, you're worth it? You're worth it in my life to give my all for you. People around me might not understand. Other Christians sometimes might look at me and go, what are you doing? But giving your life for Jesus Christ and saying, God, here is everything I have. Living that living sacrifice. Being that living sacrifice. Saying, God, I'm giving everything I have to you. Because I know that you have my back. Because I know that you are the Almighty God of the universe. I know what you've done through your Son, Jesus Christ, and how your Son came into my life. Took me and my nastiness and my sin. Cleansed me from the inside out. Put his righteousness on my account, so when God the Father looks at me, he sees his Son's righteousness. And I am clean before the Father as a child of God. Because of that, is God worth it to you to live all out for him? And all of us today as Christians are probably going, yes, 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 in our hearts. It's so easy to say. Let me just say this to you today. I'm a big talker, just being really honest with you. I love to talk. I love to say things about my spiritual life. I love to preach. I love to talk about the Bible with students. But in my daily life, sometimes I really struggle to actually put it into action. I really struggle with my devotion sometimes. I really struggle with my prayer life. I really struggle sometimes to live selfishly, selflessly before my wife, be a servant to her. I really struggle sometimes being a servant at church, even though I get paid for it. I struggle with it. Sometimes when I walk into youth group, honestly, I just want to be at home on the couch. I struggle. I have to look at my life and say, God, because of what you've done for me, am I living my life? Do I have friends around me that hold me up, that ask me the tough questions, that sharpen me? Am I sharpening others? And am I looking at my life and going, God, in every aspect, every single compartment of my life, am I going all out for you because of who you are in my life? How can I have courage to stand? Number one. Put your faith and trust in our big God. Are you doing that today? Have you trusted him for your salvation? Are you trusting him in your daily life with every aspect? Giving it to him, letting him help you, letting him control your life. Number two, are you surrounding yourself with friends you can trust and you can count on? Again, do you have friends asking you the tough questions? Do you have friends in your Christian life that come behind you and hold you up? Do you have friends in your life that say, you know what, even though you're going through a rough time, I'm going to be with you every step of the way? And when God says, here's an opportunity to have courage, you go all out. You say, God, because what you've done for me, here's my life, my sacrifice to you. I want to live a life that pleases you. Courage. Do we have courage to live lives that please God? Live lives that honor him? How are you doing today at standing up for what's right? How are you doing today at living for him? Do you have the courage to say, God, here's my life. Use it the best way you can to bring you glory. I want to play a song by Chris Tomlin. And as we sing this, as we hear this song as it's played, I'd like you to listen to the words. I'd like you to look at your life as well. Am I in my life living in a way that brings honor and glory to God? Do I have courage to stand up for what's right? Do I trust in my God? Do I have friends around me? Am I being a friend that helps each other grow closer to God? Am I going all out for God in the way that I live? Whom shall I fear? God of angel armies.
Always by my side.
Each one of us have an opportunity this week to live a life that pleases God and have the courage to step up for Him. Each one of us, if we're children of God today, we serve a God that's almighty, that's all powerful, the God of the universe, the God that came down and wrapped Himself in human flesh for each one of us. He deserves our best. He deserves that we have courage in our lives to stand up for Him. How are you doing at loving each other? At being a friend that asks the hard questions? At being a friend that has your friends' backs? Not just to coddle them when they need it, but maybe stepping up in their lives. And in love, getting them back on track with Jesus Christ. Being a real friend, sharpening each other. Having the courage to stand up and do what's right. Father, thank you so much for the chance we have this morning to be your children. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the example of Jonathan and Arnie the armor bearer. Thank you for the chance we have this morning to live lives that please you. Help us to have the courage to stand up for what's right. Help us have the courage to be different in this world. Help us have the courage to live for you no matter what. Help us to be friends that lift each other up and bring each other closer to you. Help us to find friends like that. Help us to be that kind of friend as well. Thank you so much for your salvation in our life. In your name, amen.